To all those people watching, I like to remind everyone that this video is not made for kids. It's for older fans and adults. Enjoy the fucking video! It was a beautiful morning, and Thomas was puffing cheerfully into Vicarstown Station with a local. The station was crowded with people with their cameras. Gordon was waiting in the station too with his express train, and he was feeling very grumpy. "Isn't it a lovely day, Gordon?" asked Thomas. "Puh," snorted Gordon crossly. "What's good about it?" "What's the matter with you, Gordon?" "Is it because so many people aren't taking your picture?" laughed Thomas. Gordon hissed steam. "Rubbish! It's not that! It's..." But before he could say anything else, he heard a familiar whistle. Him! Thomas could see a large green engine puffing into the station with two massive green tenders. "Oh, it's Scott! Hello, Thomas!" whistled Scott happily as he glided through the station. "Hello, Gordon!" Flying Scotsman, or Scott as he prefers to be called, was visiting the island of Sodor on a rail tour. It had been 1 year since the Great Railway Show, and so many people who had attended wanted to see the engines of the Northwestern Railway. But Gordon was not pleased. He was still fuming about Scott as he made his way to the big station. Gordon was still annoyed at his brother. During a race, Gordon was in a streamlined casing, and because of his rushing about with the workmen to get it done before the show, his safety valve was not assembled on the top of his boiler. Without it, steam would build up, and without such an important piece, his boiler would burst, which had sadly happened to him. Scott was sad and wanted to help, but he was distracted by the race and left Gordon behind, much to his fury. "Hey, shooting star!" laughed Scott. "Don't ever call me that," fumed Gordon. "Oh, Gordon, I was only teasing. How are you?" "Very well. My boiler has been in better shape, thanks to those who had helped me." "Well, very good." "Oh, Gordon, I want to give you some news. I will be heading to..." But before he could say anything else, Gordon steamed away. "Sorry, Scott. Have to be serviced, ready for my next train," he said, and he hissed steam at Scott, much to his confusion. What's with him? Excellent! Now that Gordon is here, I'll give you all the exciting news. In September, I will be heading to the United States of America. I will be pulling a special train filled with British goods for American investors. Everyone was surprised, even Gordon. Yes, so this will be my last visit to Sodor for the time being. Why are you all looking so worried? Aren't you pleased? "Aye, we are," replied Donald. "It's just that Queen Mary was sold to a place my driver calls Long Beach in America 2 years ago, and she's now a hotel, museum and restaurant. We're just worrying and hope that nothing like that happens to you. I don't think anything like that would ever happen to me. Puh, maybe it should, grunted Gordon. Scott was shocked by Gordon's words. What on earth do you mean? I mean, you are a famous engine, Scott. Too famous to help your only brother from a burst boiler. Then Scott suddenly remembered what Gordon was referring to. Is this about your incident with that streamlined phase you went through? I did call out to you about your problem, but... Then Scott remembered when he left Gordon behind. I just see it now. Come see the world's most famous locomotive at Café de Scotsman. Or roll up, come see Flying Scotsman at Disneyland. Gordon, I do want to apologize for not helping you, but... Pah! Why do I need an apology from you? You're much too famous to do that. Cut with the sarcasm, Gordon. I only... No need, Mr. Hollywood on Wheels. Ugh, if you're going to be like this, Gordon, perhaps you find a shed somewhere else and calm down. Ha! Maybe I should find a place. I don't want this Mickey Mouse on Wheels to be seen with a real working engine like me. Hey, I was a working engine too, Gordon. Was, rumbled Gordon, as he puffed away to find another shed. Oh, the nerve! Och, don't take it to heart, Scott. It's like that with brothers. Why, Dougie and I always argue like two dogs barking at each other. Why, one time we're arguing about which way to go when we were ploughing snow off the main line, and Dougie's tender clobbering snapped near Kelsop Road and was being pied up by the falling snow. When Thomas told me about dragging Dougie's tender with me, I just had to go and find him, because he is my brother. Scott knew that Donald was right, but over time he and Gordon were not on speaking terms, and it made Scott sad. When it was time to leave, Sir Charles, Topham Hatt, the engines, and a group of people all gathered at the station to wish Scott off. Scott was backing up to his coaches when he saw Gordon's tender in the shed close to the line. Well, Gordon, this is it. I will see you next time after I come back from the States. I know you are still angry at me, Gordon, but I am sorry for not helping you with the Great Railway Show. But I am still your brother. I hope our relationship gets back together once I return. I will always care for you, big brother. We're very sad to see that this will be your last visit for the time being, Scott. But I hope you do Sodor and the United Kingdom proud, and show them what our engines can do. Yes, sir, replied Scott. And with the guard's whistle and the wave of the green flag, Scott puffed away with Donald and Douglas leading everyone in a chorus of Yankee Doodle. A few months later, Scott was in America. He was amazed by the major difference that the US has compared to the mainland. He stopped at various places, and the people looked through his carriages at all the things that the mainland had placed on offer to the business people. He wished he could take passengers, but with him not being an American engine, it was against the law to do so. But he was having lots of fun. There's no way I'll be sold to a place like Disneyland, he chortled. He was having the time of his life. But a year later, back on the island of Sodor, the news about Scott's fate was about to be very grim.
Oh, this is terrible. What is it, sir?
Gasped Donald.
I got a call from a friend on the mainland. Apparently the new Prime Minister had revoked funding for this year's tour with Scott in America.
Revoked?
Yes, sighed Sir Charles. Apparently he doesn't think a steam engine promoting British trade is a good publicity. Oh, well, nothing else can be done now. All we hope now is that nothing can happen to Scott.
You don't suppose anything will happen to him, sir?
I don't know, Gordon. His owner is an ambitious and daring person. One that I can admire. But it's hard to foretell what will happen. Anyway, back to work, you two.
Yes, sir.
Aye, sir.
But 2 years had passed, and there was worse news. Sir Charles came out of his office and gave a deep sigh.
Is anything the matter, sir?
Asked Burko.
Is it about Scott, sir?
Yes. I just got off the phone with his... former owner.
Former?
He declared bankruptcy in London, and Scott is no longer under his ownership as he had been liquidated by Nixon's crew. Scott is now stuck in America.
Stuck, sir?
Queer, looks like your wish came true, huh, Gordon? Said Donald crossly. I bet he'll be turned into a restaurant or an attraction at Disneyland like you said when he was here. Why should you be concerned about him? You were terrible to him last time he was here. Why are you outbursting at me, Donald? You were in the same field once with Douglas when he lost that tender of his, and I'm in the same field with Scott. You told him about your incident. I may have said some terrible things to him sarcastically, but he's still my brother. Oh, sir, please do something. Can't you pay for him and make him a soda engine? I would love to, Gordon. Honestly, but I believe Scott will be too much for me to pay for. I hope someone does help him. Gordon was most disappointed. He carried on with work, but he was so sad that he did not build enough steam and became sluggish, which resulted in his trains being late, even during the Christmas season. The passengers were angry. Gordon's crew tried to soothe the passengers and told them what Gordon was going through. When the passengers were informed, they were sorry that they were cross with Gordon. Sir Charles had decided to let Gordon off the express for a little while and asked him to look after local trains instead. The months passed, and with no news regarding Scott, Gordon could not help but worry.
Please reconsider the idea of buying Scott, sir. I've lost all of my Doncaster siblings, and I don't want to lose him.
Oh, Gordon, look, I understand your worry, but I told you before I can't afford him. Your constant worrying is making you late with your trains, and I do not think Scott would want to see you like this. I am sorry for what's happening to Scott, Gordon, but what happened, it happened, and we just have to wait and see the outcome.
Gordon carried on with pulling local trains. But after hearing what Sir Charles had said, Gordon knew that he couldn't keep on being sluggish for long.
I can't be like this forever. I must get these passengers to their stations on time. Scott would have wanted me to do that.
I'll miss you, brother.
Over time, Gordon managed to get his head together, and he started to run his trains to time, eventually making him get back onto the express. Sir Charles was pleased.
Excuse me, sir. You are wanted on the telephone. It's someone from the mainland.
Oh, I wasn't expecting a call from there.
I wonder who it is. Sir Charles then took the receiver and said,
What wonderful news! I'll make the arrangements now.
One spring morning, Gordon puffed into the big station ready to pull the express. Sir Charles Topham Hatt was waiting for him.
Gordon, I'd arrange your next express service as far as Vicarstown, because there's someone I'd like you to meet when you get there.
Okay, sir, but who is it?
You'll soon find out, chuckled Sir Charles.
When Gordon arrived at Vicarstown, he was trying to look for this someone that Sir Charles had told him about. But no one was there apart from some photographers who were taking his picture.
I think they're the someone the Fat Controller told me about.
He was turned around on the turntable and he puffed back to his train. Suddenly he heard another whistle,
but it was not just any sort of whistle. Hello, Big Brother! Gordon could hardly believe it. Next to him was Scott, all safe and sound from America. Gordon was at a loss for words, but tears were welling up in his eyes. Did you miss me, Gordon? Of course I did, said Gordon, who had found his voice sobbing with tears of happiness. Oh, Scott, could you ever forgive me for saying such horrible things I said to you 4 years ago? Gordon, I did forgive you. I am sorry for not helping you at the Great Railway Show myself. I should have been there for my brother who needed me the most in some silly race. I am also sorry for boasting about my fame and belittling you as well. Can you forgive me? Of course. I'm glad to see that things did work out well in the end, said Sir Charles, who was on Gordon's train. Sir, you knew about this? I did. Gordon, this is Scott's new owner, Sir William McAlpine. He told me that he bought Scott before he was to be put up for sale over in the States. I had arranged with him to let him see you and do a tour of Sodor. Today, you and Scott are to race with each other to the big station, non-stop. Oh, yes, sir, whistled Gordon happily. Once the enthusiasts got on board the two engines, they both puffed happily away. Welcome home! Speeches were made by Sir Charles and Scott's new owner, and everyone took their photographs.
After the celebrations, Gordon and Scott were talking in the yards.
Do you think you will ever travel to another country, Scott?
I don't think for quite some time, Gordon. Although I was invited to Australia and Japan while I was in the States, so you never know where the road might take me.
Oh no, Scott, don't think like that. I was just kidding, Gordon, chortled Scott, and he and Gordon laughed and laughed.
But we know, don't we, that the United States would not be the only country that Scott had visited.